our journey today. We're going somewhere today in the book of Deuteronomy, and we're going to be talking about idolatry. Oh, not yet. There we go. All right, God's seatbelt. God's seatbelt is the title of our lesson today. I hope you're all wearing your seatbelts on the way here to church. I'm sure you were. Deuteronomy chapter 10 is where we're going to start. And let me ask you though, do you like...
You said five.
I said five, I meant 10.
That's five there.
That's because the main part of the sermon is in chapter 5, but the introduction is in chapter 10.
You carry on.
There you go, there you go. That's it. We're starting in 10, going back to 5. So that's where we are. Hey, do you like wearing a seatbelt?
Yeah.
Like it?
No.
Like it emotionally?
No.
Or intellectually?
Very restrictive.
Very restrictive, isn't it? Yeah, you know, you can't do all the things you want to do. Okay, so I mean, it's an interesting thought, isn't it, though? Intellectually as opposed to emotionally? Or something like that, right?
Yeah.
So what is it about wearing a seatbelt we might not like? You can't climb over into the back seat if you're wearing the front seat. Is that something you often want to do? Is that what happens when Jeanette is driving? You want to climb into the back seat? Okay, yeah, I've been in that couple of times. Yeah, I've been there. Any other reasons? Why might we not like wearing? Yeah, Pip?
Restrictive.
Feels restrictive, yeah?
Yeah.
Rubs your neck. If you're a bit short, sorry, Michelle. Okay, right.
Surely not.
You're not very comfortable. You're not very comfortable.
May not feel comfortable. Yeah, you've got something across you. Yeah. Maybe hard to get the right height or tension. Depends how much you've got around the middle, of course. How tight it might feel around there. I don't know. Yeah. What about the fact, why would we like to wear a seatbelt?
Safe.
Feel safe?
Safe.
For safety?
You won't get a fine.
Is it the same in Ireland? You get
allegedly,
fined? Yeah. I was in Singapore recently, and the taxi driver told me it's a mighty fine city. I said, what do you mean? He says, well, for everything you do wrong, you get a mighty fine. and I think that's actually true in Singapore. But yeah, we don't like the idea of getting a fine. No, that's true. I think when the law was first brought in the UK, it was the driver's responsibility if the passenger didn't wear a seatbelt. So you had to make your passenger wear a seatbelt or you got a fine. I think it's been changed now, isn't it? Each person's individual responsibility.
More than 18, then they have responsibility. If the kids, then it's your responsibility.
Oh, the kids is different, yeah, but if it's an adult, it's your problem. Okay. Yeah. It's an interesting thing. Of course, betraying my age, I go back to a period when seatbelts were completely optional, front or back.
Wow.
And when I was a kid, we drove down long journeys without motorways in those days, from where my parents lived up in the north of England down to my grandparents on the south coast, which was a 4 or 5 hour journey as a small child, without the use of any thing to distract you whatsoever. I mean, nothing. I mean, I couldn't read a book because it made me travel sick. So... there was just nothing to do for 4 or 5 hours, and but there were no seatbelts, and so it was dangerous, I think. But also, we had one of those old cars. We had an old Hillman Minx, which none of you have ever heard of. Anyway, it was an old car, and it had like sort of plastic seats, sort of thing where you just slid every time you go around a corner, and you're a kid, so you know you just slide from one side. And there's me and my sister on the back seat, and we keep sliding into each other. We go around a corner because you know what a parent that's like. Because as soon as I slide on her side, she's like, "Dad, he came on my side," and then she slides onto my side. And we're, "Dad, Mum, she's on my side," and there was nothing to stop you from doing that because there were no seatbelts. And if you're seatbelted in, at least you're stuck on your side, you know. So I think my parents were quite glad when seatbelts came in. When our kids were very small, you had to put your kids in a baby child in a baby seat. But we had no seatbelts in the back of our car because our car was an old car and it was made at a time when rear seatbelts were optional. So we had to go and buy seatbelts and drill into the frame of the car to drill in the fittings to fit seatbelts in the back of our old car. It's funny how we take for granted some of the safety things we have today. And we take those things for granted without necessarily realizing how important they are. When I was in sixth form at school, and all of our sixth formers were eager to start driving. Do you remember that time when you were getting to the age when you could think, I can start driving soon? And a policeman and a retired driving instructor came into our school and gave a lecture to all the boys of our year. And they told us horrific stories of mutilations that happened when people weren't wearing their seatbelt. And they were there, they'd been there at these events and they'd seen what had happened, and it was graphic. I'll spare you the details now. Some of us probably know people have been injured in car accidents, and that's very tragic. But all the more so if you weren't wearing a seatbelt. And we take for granted these things. We don't often realise that pulling that strap across, and the what was the old can't click every trim. All right, of a certain generation we remember. Okay, can't click every trim. Well, that was the campaign, the government's campaign, pulling it across and clicking it goes. And we are protected from so much that we don't even notice and realize. Mm-hmm. And I want to look at the topic of idolatry from this perspective. That when God gives us instructions to avoid things and to stay focused on the right things, it's for our benefit. It's for our good. It is not God trying to give us a hard time, prevent us having fun, or even prevent us from being free. We may feel more free when you're not wearing a seatbelt, but actually, you are basically more free to get injured. Yeah. You're not really that much free, more free, not really. But with God, He gives us these restrictions, He gives us these instructions because they are part of His love of protection for His people. Chapter 10 of Deuteronomy, we will go to chapter 5 in a minute, but just here in chapter 10, and picking it up in verse 12. And now, Israel, what does the Lord your God ask of you but to fear the Lord your God, to walk in obedience to Him, to love Him, to serve the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, and to observe the Lord's commands and decrees that I am giving you today for your own good. For your own good. Keeping God's commands honors Him and helps Him to be honoured and recognised by the other nations and so on. But he gives us these for the Israelites, for their own good. And this is why God gives us commands even now. It's about love. It's about relationship. It's not a set of rules, basically. Let's go back to chapter 5 now. And think about what threatens the Israelites most in terms of inheriting all the promises that God has offered them, all the good things. What threatens this the promises the most? And I would say, looking at the book of Deuteronomy, that the key issue is idolatry. Rudy touched on that when he preached a couple of weeks ago, talking about worship, and there's a lot of overlap between the topic of worship and idolatry. But it is idolatry that threatens it, and I think still threatens for us today, our enjoyment of all the potential benefits and blessings of being a Christian. As Tony talked about today, the friendship thing. I mean, that thing in John 15 is amazing. When Jesus says, you'll be my friends. Mm-hmm. And He says, I no longer call you servants, but friends. Yeah. Brothers and friends. I mean, I've been a Christian 30 odd years. I can't get my head around that. Jesus, my master. Jesus, my Lord. Jesus, my inspiration. Jesus, my savior. Jesus, my friend. I think I'm going to be growing into that for the rest of my life. Mm. I guess we all are. But that's the promise. And I would say even today that for us, the challenge of New Covenant idolatry, perhaps, is the greatest threat to us enjoying this friendship. Mm. So let's look here in Deuteronomy 5 and pick it up in verse 6. Chapter 5, verse 6. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. And we'll stop there just for the moment. So we're going to spend our day, the rest of our time here, based in Deuteronomy 5, although we'll make some forays into the New Testament to look at some New Covenant principles for our lives as well. So let's talk about three things today. Firstly, what we need to know about ourselves. What do we need to know about ourselves when it comes to idolatry? What did the Israelites need to know about themselves? Not just about God, but about themselves. And what do we need to know? If we want to know how to respond to the gospel, to the Bible, to God's commands, we must first, I think, understand ourselves, that we essentially are prone to idolatry. That is just something that's part of who we are. We have a challenge with it, and every one of us does, and any of us who thinks he doesn't, or she doesn't, is deluded. And hopefully not self-deceived, maybe you didn't realise, but now hopefully you'll be not deceived. We are all prone to idolatry. It's an interesting topic, this topic of idolatry, because we don't tend to think of it in normal parlance, the way we talk about, at the office you don't talk about idolatry. You might talk about other ethical issues, but it's not something we talk about very much. But it is key, because all human beings worship something or somebody. Everybody does. Have you noticed the outpouring of love for Roger Federer now that he's won another Grand Slam? I mean, it's like an incredible idolatry for some people, I think. Yeah. And I'm very happy for Roger, and that's all very good. But, there are these icons, right? And there are things in our lives that people or things we worship. We worship our mothers. We worship our children. We worship our boss or our potential career and opportunities. We worship all kinds of things that we value so much that they capture the heart in a way that God never intended. These things are to be enjoyed and reveled in some ways, but not to be worshipped. Jesus said in Matthew 6, no one can serve two masters. There's only one room for one master in every human being's heart. Just the one. No one can serve two masters. It's Matthew 6:24. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. And I think money is just used there as a placeholder. You can put anything in there. But you can't serve two masters. That's the point. Only one. But we have a tendency to shift away from an allegiance we've already claimed. Yeah. And are in danger of this problem. Of course, money isn't really the issue. Abraham was very wealthy. But he was a man who loved God, and that was fine, right? So it's not really about the amount of money one has, but it's about the place of it. Where is it? Is it in the heart where God is meant to be? Why should we worship anything material? Anything material is never enough, is it? I mean, we probably, all of us here, had times of plenty and times of want. Times of need and times of plenty. The times of need weren't easy, but frankly, sometimes the times of plenty weren't easy. Need, I mean, because you just get unsatisfied and it's empty. Rick Mobbs, some of us will know, or we might know David, his son, of course, is getting married next month.
Wow.
Which is exciting. And but Rick once said to me in his office, one of the common sayings in his office when he used to work for Siemens, they used to say, he who dies with the most toys wins. That was one of their sayings. He who dies with the most toys wins. He said, no, that's not true. He who dies with the most toys dies. That's it. And isn't that true? It's never a good thing for our relationship with God to allow any toy, any passing material thing to capture the heart. These things pass. We are rebellious by nature. It started in the Garden of Eden, did it not, in Genesis chapter 3. And we struggle with idolatry the same way. And Colossians chapter 3, maybe keep your finger in Deuteronomy 5 and have a look in Colossians 3 with me. You know, we think, oh, those Israelites, yeah, they had all these hills and shrines and statues, and it's all old, thousands of years ago. It's nothing to do with me today. Well, here's an interesting thing in Colossians chapter 3 and verse 5. Colossians 3 verse 5. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming in. You used to walk in these ways, and then he says, but move on from that. It's interesting that this isn't written as part of a gospel message to some non-believers. This is written to a church. And he's not talking just about where you used to be. He's giving them this list because it's creeping back into their lives. That things like immorality and impurity and lust and evil desires and greed, they're coming back into the church. They're coming back into the lives of Christians. And he says basically what these things are is their idolatry. Because these things matter more to you now than purity, than a holiness before God. How sad it is that thing where we had such joy in the waters of baptism, right? Remember the joy in the waters of baptism and that sense of freedom. It's all gone. The sin is gone. The guilt is gone. The accusations have gone. My destiny has changed. I'm now a child of the light. I'm in the kingdom. I mean, all of that purity and that beauty, but somehow over the years, it doesn't seem valuable. And as a Christian, we get confused by what's most important. And so we're urged here to remember what's really important. And the good news is that even though we have a tendency towards this, there is hope for us. Mm. We can deal with this idolatry. Mm. Absolutely can, because we have God's help. 1 Thessalonians, have a look there as well. We'll go back to Deuteronomy in a little while. But 1 Thessalonians and chapter 4, come there with me. Sorry, chapter 1, I beg your pardon. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. I love this description that Paul gives to the Thessalonians of themselves. And he says this, chapter 1, verse 4. For we know, brothers and sisters, loved by God, that he has chosen you, because our gospel came to you not simply with words, but also with power, with the Holy Spirit, and deep conviction. You know how we lived among you for your sake. You became imitators of us and of the Lord, for you welcomed the message in the midst of severe suffering with the joy given by the Holy Spirit. And so, you became a model to all the believers in Macedonia and Achaia. The Lord's message rang out from you, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, your faith in God has become known everywhere. Therefore, we do not need to say anything about it, for they themselves report what kind of reception you gave us. They tell how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the coming wrath. He rescues us from the coming wrath. They turned from idols by the power of the Spirit, and so can we. So can we. Anything that's captured your heart recently, that's in the wrong place in your life and heart, God can rescue you from that. You've got to let the power of the Spirit in, though. It doesn't happen by just saying, right, I shall just have better quiet time. I mean, there is a place for obedience, and we understand that, and Tony talked about that, but it's a bit more than that, isn't it? It's about a heart change. It's about, God, I need your help. I mean, something we see in the Gospels a lot with the people who come to Jesus is the people that get helped by Jesus spiritually, practically, physically, when they're healed, they come to him with true desperation. They don't just sort of saunter up to Jesus and like, nah, you know, if you've got a minute, I've got a bit of a problem, but it's not that big a deal. That's not how people come to him. The rich ruler, and he doesn't get it right, but at least he comes to him and falls on his feet, on his knees. The lepers in Luke 17, they call out at a distance, shouting, Lord, Master, have pity on us. I mean, the blind man, blind Bartimaeus, Jesus, son of David, isn't it, I think, quoting that right? You know, have mercy, come and help me. It's the desperate people who get Jesus to come and touch them or speak to them and help them. It's Zacchaeus, desperate enough to climb a tree, right? That it's not just they earned it, it's more there's a state of heart there that then Jesus is able to work on and work with. And I'd say if any of us feel like we've been stuck with an idol, stuck with something that's just confusing us and blanking God from us and hiding God from us, that well, open your heart to God. I mean, have a repentant moment. You know, I mean just that change of mind and heart that lets God back in. And that will make all the difference. So there are some things we need to know about ourselves, which is that we will worship something or someone. We are rebellious by nature, but there is also hope. There is. Second thing we need to know is not just about ourselves. The second thing is we need to know about our idols, about what they are. I'm not going to labour this point because I think it's fairly clear, but what we need to know about idols is that they are empty and destructive. They have no power. They have no ability to help us in the long term. It's not so much that any particular thing is wrong. The idols of the Old Covenant, of the land in which the Israelites were going to, they were made of metal and wood and stone. It's not that metal, wood, and stone are in themselves evil. That's not the point, right? God made those things good, and they're fine. They're those materials. It's more what they're made into. It's what they represent that is their problem. They obscure God. In Deuteronomy 30, maybe we'll turn away from chapter 5 for a moment here. In chapter 30, towards the end of Deuteronomy, it's about trust. really. It's about trust. Deuteronomy 30, thanks. In verse, let's start in verse 15. Chapter 30, verse 15. See, I set before you today life and prosperity, death and destruction. For I command you today to love the Lord your God, to walk in obedience to him, and to keep his commands, decrees, and laws. Then you will live and increase, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away, and you are not obedient, and if you are drawn away to bow down to other gods and worship them, I declare to you this day that you will certainly be destroyed. You will not live long in the land you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. What's God concerned about here? That their hearts will be drawn away. It's not that he has a set of rules that everybody must tick the boxes for. He's not sitting there with his list and ticking things off. He's noticing that hearts are drawn away. And, you know, I don't know about you, but one of the most delightful things for me about becoming a Christian was that I now knew how my heart could be united with God's heart. Mm-hmm. Now I've experienced this. There's a unity between my heart and God's heart through what Jesus has done for me, through the forgiveness of sins and repentance and baptism. Mm-hmm. What an amazing thing. Mm-hmm. God's concerned about our hearts. Let's be as concerned about our hearts as he is. Yeah. Mm. Yeah. I had a panic attack about 10 years ago. I didn't know what it was. I'd never had one before. At least not that I recognised, anyway. And it was a Friday night before church. And I was going to church in Harrow. I was living in Harrow. And I was getting ready. I had everything ready. And it was not long before church. And I had this weird feeling come over me. It's really sort of like all the blood. I thought I was going to faint. My blood disappeared. I started getting tingling. I thought, I'm having a heart attack. That's actually what I was thinking. I thought, I'm having a heart attack. Yeah. Lydia was there at home with me, and I just sat down on the floor. I just slumped down and sat on the floor, and she looked at me, and I said, Lydia, call for an ambulance. I have no idea what's happening. And I didn't want to say, I think I might be having a heart attack, because yeah. Yeah, I didn't want to spook her, but I said, but I want you to phone them, like, now. You know, phone the ambulance. I just sat there, and she phoned, and they came really quickly. Paramedics, they came in and they had all this stuff, you know. If you've ever had any of these experiences, they got tons of stuff with them. And defibrillators and portable ECG machines and all kinds of stuff. They came in, they were amazing, totally calm, totally professional, and put all these wires on me and then started monitoring my heart, and they took some readings, and they said, well, you look okay, but there's this tiny little blip there we're not quite sure about, so they put me in the ambulance. They strapped me in a chair. So I'm strapped in a chair. I think I can walk now. Nope, sit in the chair. So I'm wheeled out of my own house. And then, of course, the ambulance is in the street and all the neighbours are coming out. I'm like, what's going on? I'm fine. They took me off to the hospital and did lots of other tests and stuff. Mm. And turns out my heart was fine and it was a panic attack. Mm. But you know, it was, and I don't mean that to minimise a panic attack. It's a very serious thing for some people. And I've had not many, but two or three. But the thing that really inspired me was how concerned everybody was to make sure that my heart was okay. The paramedics saw one time. Really, the ECG was fine, really. But there was one tiny little thing they weren't quite sure about. So into the hospital, batteries of tests, in overnight. I had people coming in to visit me. Andrew Agabat came in. Are you all right? I'm like, yeah, I think I am, really. But they're doing all these tests. And they were all praying for me at church that night. So I don't know who else did the lesson. Somebody else must have done everything. I don't know what happened, you know. But I still have the ECGs at home in my filing cabinet. And I keep them, not because of any medical reason, but because they're a symbol. They're a symbol of someone really being concerned for my heart. No one should be more concerned about my heart than me, spiritually. No one should be more concerned about your heart than you. Idols can turn our hearts away from God. Let's be properly concerned about it. Not in a panicked way. Not in that sense of there is no hope. But an understanding that these things enslave us. Unless we are sober about their power. Let's turn to Hebrews chapter 12. And I think we'll finish on this point here. Hebrews 12 I find to be a very helpful and challenging passage, but I think it can help us. Hebrews 12. Beginning of chapter 12. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Jesus is our inspiration. Now, think of all the temptations that he had. He was tempted in every way just as we are, yet was without sin. Hebrews chapter 4. He was tempted to be idolatrous. I mean, that's what the devil tempted him with in Luke chapter 4 or Matthew chapter 4 in the wilderness, right? Bow down and worship me. I'll give you everything. He was tempted with that. But he overcame that because of the power of his spirit and his connection with God and his desire to be close to, if like the heart of the Father. And that inspiration is for us too. He says, throw off everything that hinders and entangles so you can run the race. I don't run anymore. My knees won't allow me to do that. They protest. But Michael does a lot of running. And some of us here, any other runners, serious runners? Richard, you run, don't you? You cycle and kind of, you do everything really. Running around. Well, of course, some of us mothers are running around a lot, I know, and then perhaps fathers after our children. There's something about running, but you need to be properly equipped, right? So he says, throw off everything that's hindering your race. So, can you imagine? So, I brought a few extra things with me today. This is so dirty, you can tell it's from my garage. But can you imagine? Michael, what's the most recent race you did?
Bristol Half Marathon.
The Bristol Half Marathon?
Yeah.
So when you got there, what were you wearing for the race?
Shorts, training shorts, top,
shirt. Were you wearing Wellington boots?
Definitely not.
No?
Okay.
These socks are called Quiet Rebellion. That's what they're called. Because they're hidden, see? It's just a little hint there. Penny bought me these socks. Yes, she did. That's right. She did. She is quiet, very quietly rebellious.
She's quite a rebel.
So you know, you're going for a race and you're wearing your shorts and stuff, right? But you're not going to put on extra clothes, are you? I mean, if it's really, really cold, I suppose you might wear some kind of other top, maybe.
Yeah.
But not much, right? You wouldn't take a suitcase to a race. Now, you take a suitcase when you go on holiday. There's one you can open. Here we go. Okay, so let's see. What should we do? Yeah, so I really want to run the Christian race, right? But I want to do it my way. So I want to be able to get drunk, so I'll put on a layer of drunkenness, right? Or I want to hold on to the bitterness towards my parents from when I was young and they didn't treat me the way they should have. So I want some bitterness, so I'll definitely put that on. And then, of course, there's a lot of envy of my neighbours who seem to have an easier life than me, and they seem to spend their money the way they want, and I don't want to spend my money being hospitable or for missions or for charitable work or anything like that. Of course, it's my time. I want to be selfish with my time because I've got so many demands on my time. I want to keep that for myself. So I think I'll hold on to that because that's really important. I can still be a Christian. I can still be a Christian. I can still make it work. See? And then, hang on. And what else? Yeah, you know, I mean, flirting in the office isn't all that bad, is it? I mean, everybody does it. So, and everybody enjoys it. So I think a bit of flirting in the office, that's all right. And what else can we have? Let's add on some, I don't know.
Greed
with food.
Greed.
Food.
Food. Okay, yeah, I mean, I will solve all my problems by eating more. Especially more apple crumble. Right. Because you know, God made all things good and food is good. Therefore, I should eat as much of it as possible, right?
Yeah.
So that's the solution to all my problems, right? and I should be harsh towards my children because my father was harsh towards me, and I turned out okay, didn't I? I don't know. Okay, and then I think I still really want to be a Christian, but I don't want to come to church more than, you know, every other week or so, because I've got a lot of things to do, so I think now I'm ready to run the Christian race. What do you think? I mean, Michael and I, Bristol Half Marathon, you dress in your shorts, I'll dress in this, and let's see how we do. How am I going to do?
You'll lose
weight. I'm losing weight even as we speak. I mean, what's the point trying to run the Christian life with this lot? No wonder we get tired of the Christian life. No wonder we know it's a burden to go to church. No wonder it's, oh, I can't reach out to anybody. No, I'll give my money to the church. It's because it's a burden, because we're holding on to all these idols.
Right.
And then we don't have any freedom. We think we're free. But just like the Israelites, they're tempted by all these idols. God says, don't even look at them. In fact, destroy them. Get rid of them. Because you, if true freedom is my heart and your heart together on the same page. Yeah. That's true freedom.
Wow.
We need to know about God that He will only do us good. And He loves us more than we can possibly imagine. So as we think about this today and the challenge of idolatry, I encourage us that let's know ourselves. Let's be sober about ourselves. We actually love idols, but God can purify us. There is hope. We can be purified from this. Idols are empty. They seem to offer a lot, but they actually offer nothing. Very temporary fun and relief. And the fact about God is that He only tells us to avoid these idols because He knows they are empty. And He knows they'll discourage us. And He knows they'll steal our heart. And He loves us. Mm-hmm. And He wants our hearts to be one with Him. So let us throw off everything that entangles and run the race with perseverance, for God loves us. Amen.